I'm Caroline Hyde. This is Bloomberg Technology. Coming up, Intel hits the ignition switch on its dream for driverless cars with a $15 billion acquisition. Details on how the deal to buy Mobileye went down. Plus, the $4.5 billion Verizon-Yahoo deal almost never closed. We've got the inside track on how it nearly got derailed. And Airbnb goes on the economic charm offensive, as Airbnb CEO Brian Chesky says we could see an IPO in about a year. Chesky's own words ahead. First to our lead, Intel is spending $15 billion for a foothold in the self-driving car market. The US chip maker is buying Israeli company Mobileye, which makes chips for cameras and driver assistant features. In the second largest acquisition ever for Intel and the largest ever for an Israeli company, shares of Mobileye surged on the news as Intel's offer represents more than 30% premium at Friday's closing price. Bloomberg editor-at-large Corey Johnson caught up with Intel CEO Brian Krzanich earlier and asked him, well, why he's shelling out so much money for self-driving car technology right now.
We think combining Intel and Mobileye allows us to have a singular platform end-to-end for our customers. But more importantly, if you take a look at where autonomous driving is going, the OEMs, the car manufacturers are today working on 2021 models. So you have to make a deal, you have to build your platform today in order to be there in 2021 when the models are really going to start hitting the road.
What is Intel? What has Intel's approach been to semiconductors within the car, and how might that change with Mobileye?
Well, we're already in a large number of the autonomous vehicles that are out there today. But what this does is really brings the best of both ends of the computing spectrum for driving together. So think about it this way. The car will have two brains. One is a vision brain that's going to take a sensor fusion, the LiDAR, the radar, the cameras, and combine that and build a view of the world. And then there's another brain that Intel currently plays in, which is going to then take that information and basically drive the car. And this puts those two brains together into one company and allows us to provide an end-to-end platform for our partners.
Do you expect Intel's other businesses to benefit from this autonomous car world? You talked in an email to your employees about data, and how important this was in the world of data.
You bet. So, there's going to be several flows of data in and out of the car. And the first is simply the car seeing the world and adapting how it drives. And so that's what we call learning data. And there'll be a data center that's built by the car OEMs that's going to be driving that and developing their algorithms. There's another set of data that will come out of the car that's the mapping data. And you saw our investment in HERE earlier this year that is really augmented towards building these precision maps, maps that have a lot more information than the maps of today that you use. And then the third set is that these cars are going to be able to see the world as they drive around. And so there's going to be just visual data that's going to be gathered on, people on the streets and cars that it's passing, and all that visual information is going to be gathered and used to build, information models of what's going on.
I'm curious about the timing of this deal, not just because of as you talk about the lead time that automobiles require, but for Intel at this stage in its growth, and also where we are in sort of a global macro sense of technological change and spending. Do you feel like you had to get ahead of competitors who might have looked at Mobileye as a potential target?
You bet. So we knew that this was a hot space, that gathering up these technologies and really building this end-to-end platform was important. And then also, this deal, although large, is immediately accretive to our earnings per share and our free cash flow for the company. So it was a good deal from that perspective as well for Intel.
That was Bloomberg editor-at-large Corey Johnson speaking with Intel CEO Brian Krzanich. Corey joins us now for a little bit more, along with navigation software expert Marc Prioleau. He leads strategy and business development at Mapbox and has worked in location technology for over 20 years with a previous position at Uber. You are quite the man to have in for today. Corey, I want to kick off with you. Basically, they admitted they couldn't grow this internally quickly enough. It had to be an acquisition.
Yeah, it sounds like also they really felt like the product cycle was just going to take them too long. Brian Krzanich is really remaking Intel into a different kind of company. I think recognizing the PC is not going to be the center of everything anymore, and it's not enough to say we're still the data center, which is what sort of the excuse they had in missing mobile telephony, saying, well, it's all got to go back to the data center anyway. They significantly missed out. They left room for Qualcomm to become a dominant company here, and I think they really don't want that to happen in the car market. The question is, ultimately, are the margins going to be there? Now, right now for Mobileye, they've got small sales of some really nice margins, and God forbid, free cash flow. But can that business be as profitable as the chip business was for Intel and the PC and Intel and the data center?
So key question in terms of going forward. Mark, the premium was pretty hefty, as we heard from Corey, more than 30%. Does it vindicate this sort of premium when you're looking what Mobileye is building now for the future? You talk about the roadside experience management sensors. Right. Is this where it's at?
Well, I think that's a big part of it. And you heard him talk about data. And that's one of the big things. You know, Mobileye's business now is collecting forward and backwards visualization and lane guidance and things like that. Most of those devices aren't connected. But one of the things they announced starting last year was the idea of connecting those up and capturing data by the roadside. And that's going to plug into these maps that are going to be needed for semi-autonomous and autonomous driving. And I think that's really one of the reasons for the premium.
Does it work well with HERE, which of course we heard Intel had bought previously, the mapping bit, you're the map expert?
Well, so it needs to work well with the mapping system. And Intel made a moderate investment in HERE a while back. It needs to work with a mapping system, because what it does is it tells you on that map, now where precisely are you? Where is the car localized? And that becomes really, really important, because you need to know things like not just what lane you're in, but when to start moving over to make turns, what your trajectory should be through an intersection. So the map needs to be there, but this other layer on top of it is, I think, where Mobileye will really be playing.
Corey, Qualcomm, is this really where it's under threat now? Are they going to be the ones sitting up worrying by this Intel purchase?
I think to some degree, yes, to some degree, no, right? So we sort of see this evolution of these devices, this evolution of these chips from where they exist right now. But the notions of what these things are going to be doing is dramatically different than what we see on the road today. And so to the extent that Qualcomm's already in some cars and that they've got, you know, with some of their acquisitions, that they've got some business in cars, I think it's a lot less important. And again, to the profitability point, the chips that Qualcomm has in cars right now are very low margin chips and low operating margin chips, and they're dumb chips as well. They're not sort of these super smart central processing unit equivalents in the car that Intel's going after. And the stuff that Mobileye is doing is at the very cutting edge. Qualcomm doesn't really have anything that's close to that.
Do you agree, Mark?
Because it's huge. And, you know, if you just think as you're driving, all the computations, and the brain's an amazing thing, but, you know, if you think about what we've got in cars now and how we navigate, we go somewhere, we turn right, but really what happens is you're moving over into lanes, you're making a trajectory, you're setting your speed. The car needs to sense all those things. And one of the key things is the maps can't be static because they change at all times. And so that ability to capture all that new data, everything that's new, and then feed it back in near real time and update those maps is part of what I think they're buying. It is a bet on the future, though. It clearly is.
And this is sort of what investors have to digest, don't they, Corey? The share price went down a little bit for Intel today. Was it about a couple of percent? But Morgan Stanley putting out a note saying that maybe could have used their money better if they were just buying back their own stock. How much does Intel need to sort of educate the investor that this is the right sort of long-term bet?
Well, I don't know if it's educated. I mean, you know, Intel's taking a lot of money to move into what is right now a very small business. Yeah. Now, you know, Brian Krzanich is thinking about the future of Intel, not how to manage the stock price today. And I think he really wants to put his stamp on this company. We see in a lot of the moves that he's made as a CEO of Intel. But, you know, the buying back of shares, absolutely it would have been more accretive in the short term. The question is, how big can this business be in this assisted driving space that Mobileye is so focused on? And that's the ultimate question here. How big will that business be, number one? And number two, what will the profit margins be like in that business? To this point, the margins on most things in cars are quite small, are almost always single digits. And that goes top to bottom, stem to stern, if you'll use a sailing metaphor in a bit of car.
But let's mix them up.
Why not? I mean, the margins have been pretty weak. And so their hope is that they're going to get some sort of double-digit high margins. But, you know, Intel's a company that's been used to 50, 60% gross margins, operating margins in the teens. Whether or not the automotive industry can provide that for them is an open question.
Something we'll come back to, Mark, for more analysis with in the future. Yeah. Thank you very much indeed, gentlemen, for joining me. Of course, Marc Prioleau of Mapbox and our editor-at-large, Corey Johnson. Now, Uber competitor Halo is coming to a full stop in London. Customers are now being encouraged to switch to ride-hailing app MyTaxi. Last July, Daimler bought a majority stake in Halo and announced plans to merge the company with MyTaxi. The Hamburg-based company has already moved more than 17,000 drivers who previously used the Halo system to the MyTaxi app and plans to start converting the UK customers this week. Halo users in London have until the end of May to switch. Coming up, Airbnb CEO Brian Chesky speaks on everything from globalization, jobs, and the company's IPO process. We'll bring you the highlights next. This is Bloomberg.
We don't have anything to announce. We are working on making sure the company is ready to go public. And so, you know, we've always said it was a two-year project. We're probably halfway through that project as far as just being ready to go public.
A story we're watching, new revelations from the ongoing negotiations between Verizon and Yahoo. Turns out, after details of Yahoo's massive security breach, Verizon's CEO suggested a price cut of as much as $925 million for the deal. He also considered tabling the deal entirely before the two companies eventually agreed on a price cut of $350 million, or a sale price of $4.5 billion for Yahoo's core internet assets. Now, we're going to dig into all the details of the talks and what is next for Yahoo's CEO, Marissa Meyer, later this hour. And as we heard a few moments ago, CEO Brian Chesky of Airbnb said the company is halfway through its two-year IPO process. And as the company inches closer to going public, it's also trying to improve the economic standing of Airbnb. Landlords launching an economic empowerment agenda aimed to create more opportunities for those who use the service. Speaking at the Economic Club of New York luncheon, Airbnb CEO Brian Chesky spoke about, well, that as well as the global job market.
The change is only beginning. You know, if you think of Moore's Law, it basically means that technology, like processors, double in speed every 2 years. What it basically means is that the next 10 years will change a lot more than the last 25. In fact, the next 100 years, the world might change as much as the last few thousand. And so the way we live in cities is going to completely change. Some changes we need to be prepared for. I'll give you one example of a change we need to be prepared for. So we have a new president of the United States. And I would say the root of Donald Trump becoming president, one root was global economic uncertainty in the United States. People feeling like maybe they aren't better off than they used to be. They're angry. And then there's different perceived causes, like globalization. And maybe there was a real impact of globalization on people's jobs. The thing is, and this is a reality, that globalization is nothing compared to automation. So will jobs come back to New York? Will manufacturing come back to the United States? Of course, a huge amount of it is. But it doesn't mean jobs will come back. Because made in America shouldn't, now the labels may as well say made in parentheses by robots in America. Because that's what technology is going to do. And if you look at all these technology companies, what they're doing is automating and automating. Because actually robots are going to be cheaper than China. And so automation is a huge thing. Oxford did a study. I said that half of US jobs should be automated in 20 years, will be automated in 20 years. And this study was done, I think, 2 years ago. And many of us in tech believe that was a vast conservative understatement on the amount of jobs that will be automated. So I think it's important to just take a step back and realize that's the reality. Now, am I like just causing fear in the room? Is that like not gonna happen? Well, I think there's so much that's obviously going to, I think it's not an overstatement. Many people in tech think it's going to happen much sooner.
That was Airbnb CEO Brian Chesky. Now let's bring in Arun Sundararajan. He's a professor at New York University and author of The Sharing Economy. Perfect timing to have you on. And this is a fascinating speech really being given by Brian Chesky. He really tried to reinforce the jobs being created by Airbnb, 1.3 million to be supported worldwide in 2017, to seniors, to women, to urban areas as well. Is this trying to sort of charm offensively really here ahead of an IPO? Is this trying to woo the regulators?
Well, I think it's a reflection of the reality of what work in the future is going to look like. I think he put it well. I mean, you know, the jobs that are lost to automation aren't coming back. I think 7 out of 8 jobs that we lost in manufacturing over the last 15 years were lost to automation, and maybe 1 was lost to China out of 8. And so it's already like a pretty it's a pretty significant force to contend with. And so, you know, really the model of making a living in the future is going to be capital ownership. you own your own tiny business that you use to generate revenue, perhaps using some AI technology. So he's sort of simply positioning Airbnb as being sort of on the forefront of what job creation in the future is going to look like.
I mean, in fact, they call it the economic empowerment agenda. So he's talking about the jobs they can support, but also the cleaning, perhaps, that is provided, the local economies they support by helping there become tourism where there wasn't before. Do you think actually Airbnb will be a disruptor, a force for job creation or for job reduction if they end up becoming a one-stop shop for travel?
Well, I think that they're going to be a source for work creation. For income generation creation. Not all of this will come in the form of jobs that we're used to seeing. A lot of it will come in the form of millions of people running a tiny business, hosting on Airbnb, millions of others supporting them. And so that's where the clear sort of, like, you know, where we're at this fork where we have to make a choice about whether we're going to support an economic system that really empowers people to take control and to sort of create these tiny businesses rather than focusing on sort of the 20th century rhetoric of we need to create jobs.
They spoke of potentially an IPO halfway through a two-year process. You think an IPO next year?
I think that they seem ready. And I normally don't feel this way about tech IPOs. I think Snapchat went public too early. I think when Facebook went public, they went public too early. But Airbnb is a robust business. They're profitable. They're generating billions of dollars of revenue. I think the business model is pretty well set. They are already the world's largest provider by many measures of short-term accommodation. Yeah. You know, 3 million hosts compared to Marriott Starwood's 1.1 million rooms. And so, you know, they're in pretty good shape. They're a healthy business that is one of the leaders in their industry. So I see no reason why an IPO next year isn't a possibility.
Arun Sundararajan, we have more to cover with you. Do stay with us live from New York. Now, coming up, Uber is taking extra measures to prevent drivers from forming unions. We'll discuss the ride-sharing company's latest battle. That's next. This is Bloomberg. Now, Uber has always discouraged drivers from forming unions, and in Seattle, it's taking extra measures. The ride-sharing company is running advertisements against unionization in its app and on television, hosting meetings and sending emails and phone calls to drivers. There's even an Uber-run podcast that is now in its 18th episode. Back in 2015, Seattle City Council voted to allow Uber drivers the ability to form unions. This legislation took effect in January, followed by an immediate lawsuit by Uber. A hearing is expected later this month. Meanwhile, Uber has been in PR crisis mode in recent days. It's dealing with sexual harassment claims by a former engineer, as well as a lawsuit from Alphabet and a video leak showing CEO Travis Kalanick criticizing a driver. Still with us is NYU professor and author of The Sharing Economy, is Arun Sundararajan. Arun, this move, I mean, is it inevitable eventually that the drivers look for more rights, or can Uber continue to fight this?
Well, I actually think that Uber has a pretty good chance of being successful at fighting this, because there's a history of lawsuits that prevent contractors from unionizing actually prevailing. And given the current administration and the current climate, you know, it's certainly a good idea for contractors who are sort of sitting between employees and independent contractors. You know, Uber's drivers aren't really employees, they aren't really independent contractors, they're somewhere in between. So I think it's a good idea to give them some collective bargaining rights. But the way the law is written today, it's going to be a tough battle for Seattle to uphold their decision to allow them to unionize.
Arun, at the end of the day, does Uber long-term care about its drivers? It says it does. It's the year of the driver, it claims. But their real force is towards automation, no?
It is, but I think that there's a pretty uncertain path towards when we're going to have fully autonomous vehicles on the road without drivers behind the wheel. I mean, a few minutes ago, we heard about advances in the driverless technology, but it's not just the technological capabilities that are you know, a factor here. It's also, there's got to be a regulatory path. People have to be comfortable with the idea of an unmanned car on the road. So if I look at Uber's next 5 years or maybe even longer, it's certainly a world in which they're going to be very heavily dependent on their drivers. And so getting their drivers on their side is certainly an important part of their near-term strategy.
We've only got a minute left, Arun, but do you think the PR crisis can be overcome by Uber at the moment? Are they doing what is needed?
I think they're doing what is needed. I think some aspects of the PR crisis perhaps require far more action than others. I think the part of the news that perhaps poses the biggest long-term threat to Uber's business is the lawsuit from Alphabet, because that could place a roadblock in the rapid progress they've been making to put fully autonomous vehicles on the road. And in terms of convincing investors that the business model scales and that they're worth the $70 billion that they're worth, that is by far, having fully autonomous vehicles on the road is really important for Uber in the near term. And this lawsuit may have caused them to have to slow down, even if they eventually prevail in the lawsuit.
We will keep a close eye on how that progresses. Arun Sundararajan, NYU professor and author of The Sharing Economy, thank you so much for your time today. Now, still to come, Intel's $15 billion car tech deal could be a boost for the Israeli tech scene. We'll explain why. This is Bloomberg.
I'm Elisa Parenti, and you're watching Bloomberg Technology. Let's start with a check of your first word news. House Speaker Paul Ryan is defending the GOP health care bill as budget analysts project 14 million people would lose coverage next year and 24 million over the next decade. Ryan says the Congressional Budget Office analysis does not take additional steps the GOP-led Congress and the Trump administration would take to lower costs into account. Health and Human Services Secretary Tom Price spoke moments ago.
We disagree strenuously with the report that was put out. We believe that our plan will cover more individuals at a lower cost and give them the choices that they want for the coverage that they want for themselves and for the their family, not that the government forces them to buy.
Britain's House of Commons has rejected a plan that would have guaranteed the right of EU citizens living in the UK to stay before Brexit talks begin. The House of Lords must now decide whether to accept the Commons vote or resist delaying the bill's passage. A Cairo prosecutor has ordered the release of ousted President Hosni Mubarak. It ends nearly 6 years of legal proceedings against the former Egyptian leader. He was acquitted earlier this month of charges that he ordered the killing of protesters during the middle of the Eastern 2011 uprising. Global news 24 hours a day, powered by more than 2,600 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Elisa Parenti. This is Bloomberg. It's just after 5:30 p.m. Monday here in New York already, 8:30 Tuesday morning in Sydney. I'm joined by Bloomberg's Paul Allen with a look at the markets. Paul, good morning.
Good morning. Well, we're still 90 minutes away from the open here in Australia, but futures are looking up at the moment. We're expecting to open 17 points higher if they're any guide. However, futures were pointing up on Monday as well, and the ASX ended up down 18%. But we just have the one market open in the region at the moment, and that is New Zealand. The NZX currently looking flat after a fairly tepid lead from Wall Street. Nikkei futures are looking positive, however, and it might be worth keeping an eye on Toshiba today. We're waiting on a new deadline for earnings from Toshiba. That's after they missed the February 14 deadline. That's when Toshiba released provisional numbers which confirmed a $6.3 billion write-down on Toshiba's nuclear unit. Plenty of data out today as well. China retail sales and industrial production are due in a few hours' time. It was reported last week that factory prices surged at its fastest pace since 2008, and in 3 hours' time here in Australia, we're expecting the latest business confidence numbers for February. It's just some of what we're watching around the region today. I'm Paul Allen in Sydney. More from Bloomberg Technology next.
This is Bloomberg Technology. I'm Caroline Hyde. And our top story this hour, of course, Intel's $15 billion acquisition of the Israeli company Mobileye. It's the latest example of how tech giants are racing to gain a foothold in the race for developing self-driving cars. As part of the deal, Intel will move its existing car tech operations to Israel and keep Mobileye's business in its home nation. Bloomberg's editor-at-large Corey Johnson asked Intel CEO Brian Krzanich about that decision and its associated cost savings earlier.
So we built about $175 million of synergies into this deal, which, as you said, is right. They were going to go and move our autonomous driving resources to Israel, where Mobileye is centered. And, you know, there's a lot of, you know, SG&A and some R&D that is overlapped between the two companies, and that'll bring those synergies to that $175 million over time.
There was a lot of options trading in the days before this deal was announced, and I should say purchase of calls, like expectations that the stock was going to go higher and really soon. And it seemed to be near record levels for Mobileye. Yes, there was some excitement about the stock, but nothing like this. And I wonder how long you've been working on this deal and if this concerns you at all.
So we've been working on this deal for a while, but, you know, we take a lot of care, both with our bankers that we work with and the PR teams, to really keep this quiet. And if you take a look, it's been, you know, pretty quiet from what we've seen relative to other deals that are out there. And so we were pretty comfortable with the level of secrecy we were able to keep the deal under until, you know, really like the last 12, 24 hours. And, you know, we took a look at what we were doing and what was going on in the market. It seemed like it was everything was pretty okay from that perspective.
Yeah. Lastly, expectations of changes in tax policy, repatriation, which can sometimes lead to a lot of M&A, could happen in technology. Is that one of the reasons that you wanted to get this deal done now, ahead of a time when other companies might have been able to repatriate and do more M&A and the price tags might go up?
No, we would never do M&A as a result of something like that. We're always going to do target around technologies and doing the technologies at the right time relative to bringing those products to market. And that's purely what this was driven by. You know, we started these discussions before the election, to give you some clarity of just how long these take. And so that, you know, we had nothing to do with what the tax policies were. This was about getting these two technologies together to provide these solutions.
That was Intel CEO Brian Krzanich and our editor-at-large Corey Johnson. Now, Intel noted in the announcement that Mobileye's operations will stay where they are. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu of Israel tweeted earlier, "Congratulations, Mobileye, Israeli genius, Israeli pride." And while it's the biggest acquisition of an Israeli tech firm ever, it's not the first. Others include Apple buying PrimeSense, Google buying Waze, and Cisco buying NDS. Joining us now for more context on the Israeli tech scene are two venture capitalists. In New York, Lou Kerner, partner at Flight VC, and in Mountain View, Shuly Galili, co-founding partner at Upwest Labs. Thank you very much indeed for joining us, both of you. And Lou, I wanted to get to you first because you're helping manage Israelis' syndicate on the angel list. You know it well. Just how big is the scene? Because you think the world hasn't quite grasped how big it could become.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think this kind of seminal book on Israel, Startup Nation, was written in 2009. So the story isn't new, but I fervently believe that the world still has no idea about the innovation and shareholder value creation that's going to come out of Israel in the coming years.
Give us some stats, because I know you've got some great ones in terms of just the sheer amount of IPOs per person.
Sure. Well, you know, when the book was written in 2009, you know, the book was written because based on any stat you looked at, whether it was the number of startups per capita, the number of exits, the number of IPOs per capita, Israel was crushing the rest of the world. Here in the U.S., on the NASDAQ, for instance, you know, Israel leads all the other countries in the world on a per capita basis. It's more than two times the per capita number of IPOs on the NASDAQ versus Canada, and it's more than 100 times on a per capita basis the number of IPOs out of China. So again, what's happening in Israel is really quite amazing.
And Shuly, I mean, you founded the California Israeli Chamber of Commerce. You're helping building bridges between Silicon Valley and Israel. I'm finding it fascinating that Intel, actually, it was this time last year they got in on another Israeli company, Replay Technologies, for the 360-degree Super Bowl players. They've also got, what, one of the largest hirers in Israel? Just how much does Silicon Valley already know Israel?
So, First of all, yeah, we're based in Silicon Valley here at Upwest Labs and invested in over 60 companies in Israel. And it's no surprise, I think, that all eyes are on Israel from Silicon Valley, and it's been that way for about, you know, more than 20 years. If you look at some of the leading companies that are based here out of Israel, whether it's Checkpoint or earlier SanDisk, companies that are innovating in both the hardware as well as the software space, then you see also that a lot of the local funds and investors are looking to Israel for innovation. So Waze has created a lot of waves in the last 4 years with its acquisition. And I think that, you know, Mobileye is not a big surprise. In 2016 alone, almost $5 billion were invested into Israel, you know, in capital. So there is a lot of infusion of capital, and there is a lot of interest in the innovation that is going into Israel today.
Where is it going, Lou, for example? NDS was a TV software company, Waze, of course, traffic mapping. What are the key areas of growth, do you think, for Israel?
Sure. Well, NDS was really a TV set-top company, but the majority of the value in NDS, which was a $5 billion acquisition, was in the cybersecurity, the encryption of NDS. And if you take a look at kind of the major areas where Israel is amazing at, obviously cybersecurity is one of the amazing areas. I think also there are a lot of areas that come out of what I describe as imaging. So it started with satellite imaging in the 50s. So the Israelis could see what their neighbors were up to. And now they have some of the greatest photo companies, the same technology. So there's an amazing company called Lightrix doing amazing stuff with photography. They're going to be the Adobe of photos. There are amazing companies in video, amazing companies in AR, VR. Snapchat just bought a company called Cymagine. And that same technology is in the autonomous car. The LiDAR technology out of Mobileye is that same technology.
And Shuly, it's interesting. We've been hearing about how active the IPO scene is from the stats of NASDAQ companies per person, and Israel really killing it there. But do they need more IPOs, mega IPOs, to the size of $15 billion, like we've just seen this exit, to put it largely on the map? Because most of this seems to be M&A.
True. A lot of the great technologies today are being acquired. And I think that's, you know, if you look at the Israeli ecosystem, the biggest question among investors outside of Israel and in Israel also is, can Israel produce massive companies? That's always the question on the mind. Can this scale? Can companies start but also scale globally in creating impact? And I think that Mobileye has definitely, you know, put a lot of that to work in showing that companies scaling out of Israel and scaling big into areas that are really emerging, such as autonomous vehicles, artificial intelligence, and obviously some of the traditional companies such as cybersecurity and storage. But I think what we've seen recently also in looking at a lot of companies, as Lou mentioned, in new areas such as drone technology, such a company like Aerobotics that we've invested in, as well as companies that are doing amazing technology in IoT. And I think what we will see in coming in the next few years, also a lot of technology that is going to solve problems in industrial IoT, in manufacturing, and some of the old dated technologies, dated companies that definitely need infusion of innovation in order to stay relevant and to stay agile.
I'll have to leave it there, but it's a question for many a tech hub. When's the really big IPO going to come? Shuly Galili of Upwest Labs, great to have your perspective from Mountain View. And Lou Kerner, live from New York, Flight VC, thank you very much indeed. Now, coming up, just what happened during the talks between Verizon and Yahoo after details of the massive security breach came to light? We have the details of the heated discussions. This is Bloomberg. A stock we're watching, Citrix. Shares popped and closed up 7%. The cloud services company is said to be working with Goldman Sachs on a potential sale process. Now, that's according to Bloomberg sources. Goldman is sounding out potential buyers, including private equity firms. But interest has been limited. Citrix's large market valuation means buyout firms would have to team up to fund a bid, therefore complicating any possible deal. Speaking of deals, new details have come out from negotiations between Verizon and Yahoo. Verizon CEO Lowell McAdam suggested a price cut of as much as $925 million for the deal to buy Yahoo's core internet assets after the revelations of the massive data breach. And that's according to the latest regulatory filing. It also revealed that McAdam suggested killing off the deal completely before the price was eventually reduced by $350 million to $4.5 billion. Joining us to dig into this and what's next for Yahoo CEO Marissa Meyer is Bloomberg Technology reporter Brian Womack. You really delved into this 8K, and it surprises me. He seemed to really put it on the line, this deal, saying I might even kill it entirely.
Yeah, and remember, this is the CEO of Verizon. This is the highest levels of the company personally involved in this process that had been going on for months and months. He comes in on February. There's this call with a key person on the board of Yahoo. They say, well, what if we said as much as $925 million for a cut? And they just kind of left it there, according to the regulatory filing. But again, that's way on the high level of some people's expectations. Some people thought maybe $500 million. $1 billion was sort of on the high end of what I was hearing, at least.
And then, so do we understand how they managed to come back from that, Yahoo, to whittle it down to $325 million?
Well, I mean, if you read the language, it's pretty broad. It's like, well, I would suggest maybe as much as this much. And then they kind of went from there. There was apparently a meeting about 10 days later in New York City, apparently their offices. And it sounded like it was in the morning. They came together. They said, you know, what about $350 million? Yahoo, the Yahoo side said that. And so from there, they kind of came to an agreement, and that was with McAdam. And from there, you know, things started to move pretty quickly, because within 2 weeks, we had the finalized deal. Again, after all these months and months of back and forth, after the disclosures on these, you know, very big hacks.
I find it fascinating that Verizon CEO is playing such hardball, and then it seemed to actually relatively lowball it, what many felt. But how about Marissa Meyer coming out? We don't know what she's going to be doing next, but it looks as though she walks off with a decent chunk of change.
Yeah, no, she's going to be okay, apparently. $23 million now, that's down from actually as much as we thought it would be, some changes in some stocks and equities, etc. But yeah, $23 million looks to be the amount that she'll get. Now, again, you have to remember, she's actually taken some step backs on her pay. A couple weeks ago, she sort of put out this statement that she's not taking a bonus, pulling back on this year's bonus because, hey, you know, this hack was really bad. It happened on my watch. I'm going to take some stuff off the table. But that said, of course, as you said, $23 million. Not bad.
Not too bad. Talk to us about the future then, because Altaba is where spins out what's left of Yahoo, the Japanese unit, and Alibaba. That's going to be held by McKinney. He's a board member and was at IDC.
Yeah. And he's going to be sort of taking the helm of this, what they're calling the fund, actually, which is a really good name, because it's nothing more than really these huge Asian assets. They have stakes in Alibaba, Yahoo Japan, all this very valuable multi-billion dollar stakes. And so they're going to have that, some other stuff. And, you know, what happens there, we don't know. But it's going to be at least, it looks like, kind of a tracking stock probably on some of these other stuff, the other major holdings. So that's what he's going to be in charge of, as far as, like, you know, the day-to-day, the email, the website, all the stuff that we're kind of more familiar with out there. That's going all to Verizon.
Farewell, and Verizon it becomes. Always great, Brian Womack, to get your perspective. Bloomberg Technology Reporter. Now, coming up, former CIA Director General Michael Hayden says WikiLeaks has proven again to be an enemy of the United States. We'll have more on his insights next. This is Bloomberg. Elon Musk is betting he can solve a looming energy crisis in Australia in 100 days. That's with his company's battery technology. A little bit of context for you. South Australia has had a problem with recent blackouts, and the Prime Minister has blamed it on the state's rapid take-up of renewable energy. And Tesla's battery chief, Lyndon Reeve, recently claimed that the company could easily install enough batteries to prevent the blackouts. Australian tech billionaire Mike Cannon-Brookes then tweeted at Reeve and Musk asking, "How serious are you about this?" Musk replied, "Tesla will get the system installed and working 100 days from contract signature, or it's free." after a series of tweets. The two agreed on a project price of $25 million, leaving the deal in the hands of the Australian politicians to finalise. On Saturday, Musk met with Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull and discussed the priority and future of clean energy. Prime Minister Turnbull thanked Musk via Twitter for a great in-depth discussion on energy storage. Musk later replied with his excitement to discuss future of electricity in Australia. Twitter now doing billion-dollar deals, but still doesn't quite get more attracting more users, it would seem. Now to the US politics. President Trump has tweeted out that he may have been wiretapped prior to the election. In addition, the House Intelligence Committee has asked the Justice Department for any wiretapping evidence by next Monday. Earlier, Bloomberg's David Gura spoke to former CIA director Michael Hayden and asked how confident he is that any evidence will come to light.
I'm confident we'll know by Monday of next week that there isn't any evidence. My instincts are really, really powerful on this, David. I know how this works. I know how you get a FISA. I know how the U.S. government gets the authority to listen in on the phone calls of a U.S. person. And none of those things are suggested by what the president tweeted out about 10 days ago. It just doesn't happen that way. The president hasn't had the authority to order such a thing for about 40 years. You got to go to a court, and there's no evidence that that's happened because the guys who would have gone to the court, Jim Comey and Jim Clapper, have said directly and indirectly, they didn't do that.
If it didn't happen, if there's no evidence that that happened, what should the consequences be, as you see it, for the president, yes, but also what's the consequence of making that allegation on the intelligence community?
Yeah, so we've already suffered a lot of damage because the intelligence community already knows that it's not true because this is what they do for a living. And so it's just one more kind of log on that fire that seems to have been building, a confrontation between the new administration and the intelligence community. And David, there's probably sin on both sides here. So I would just suggest, as a member of the old community, but also as a concerned citizen, everyone take a deep breath and back away from this, because the president needs the intelligence community, and the intelligence community knows their only purpose in life is to help him succeed.
So there's this cache of information that WikiLeaks says is hacking data, hacking information from the CIA. What recourse does this administration have against WikiLeaks? They're increasingly in a problematic position.
They really are, and I think WikiLeaks has proven themselves to be an enemy of the United States of America, and by that my definition is they are doing things whose only purpose can be to harm America, America's friends, and the way America keeps itself and its friends safe. If there were good answers, David, in order to shut this thing down, we would have exercised those answers already. I think we just keep plugging away. You know, one thought I had, and I really can't claim that I've explored it. Have we exacted any consequences on Ecuador for giving Julian Assange sanctuary in the Ecuadorian embassy in London? You know, we are not required to make life as comfortable as possible for the Ecuadorian government.
Just a last question here. We're expecting an executive order on cybersecurity from the White House. That was expected but delayed a little while back. If you were to talk to the White House, what would you say would be priority one when it comes to cybersecurity?
Yeah, David, I've actually seen some drafts of that order, and I actually think it's quite good. It puts tasking out into the federal bureaucracy with fairly short timelines to come back and tell me how you're going to do these things. If you're looking for kind of the philosopher's stone, the secret sauce, I think the key to this is that our success or failure in cybersecurity is going to be more dependent on the success of American private industry and the private sector than anything that the U.S. government is able to do on itself. So I would counsel the president, think of things that unleash, liberate, get out of the way of the private sector doing things only the private sector can do when it comes to cybersecurity.
That was Bloomberg's David Gura speaking with former CIA Director Michael Hayden. That does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. Remember, all episodes are now live streaming on Twitter. Check us out. It's at Bloomberg Tech TV, weekdays at 5 p.m. in New York, 2 p.m. in San Francisco. That's all for now. This is Bloomberg.